remember that song? Devil's in the phone booth down 911. What's there, guys? I used to sing a lot of his songs. Gosh, I can't write them.
We don't jam, buddy. It's supposed to leave. They're here.
Yeah. Wow.
Check them out.
They got family in California?
Yeah, they were going to stay. They were going to be gone for 2 months.
Sometimes we can fly out, sometimes we can take a time to drive because it's such a the scenery out there is so beautiful.
And I think it's hard.
She's here because they won't ever go back yet. A missionary to
there's too many faces.
I know. So they're around New Zealand and that area there. Some tribes that live up in the mountains that just help them translate the word of God into their land. Yeah, I know. She said she's ready to get back.
Pastor Spiller?
She's been here. She hadn't been here that much. I don't know if she's concerned about COVID. I'm not sure. She was here last Sunday.
Yeah. She was here for coming. First Sunday. I see those people.
You know those folks?
Oh, he's been a big
one for
years and years. Is that
over here?
Really?
Yeah.
You're the one who made you, Jesus. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him. We got to pray about this morning. One thing we need to pray for is this country. Our people. Nobody knows what's going to happen. But you know we've got an almighty God. He's got it right there, brother. Right there in the palm of his hand. I want to be there, don't you? I want to be right there. Palm of his hand. Because that's safe. You're not safe nowhere else. Right there in the palm of his hand. I don't know what I would do if it wasn't for him. We were talking about, you know, before this service, we were talking about some of the things we've went through in our lives. I thank Almighty God for keeping me. I could have been dead many times. Many times, but he seemed fit to save me one day. To save me one day, Brother Green. 19 years old, I gave my heart back to him. But it was my mama's prayers that kept me safe that time between. But when I left him at 19 years old, and I just thank God, I have failed him many times, but you know, Sister Joyce, he's never failed me. We all go through the trials and tribulations. But you know, if you don't have him, you don't have no hope. But you got all hope.
Yeah.
Can you just love him one time and pray? Thank you.
week has gone well. We want to welcome what someone has termed, and I believe it, I've heard something about it, a miracle lady, and that is Chastity. She is here today, and I'm going to thank God for helping her. This is Kathy Rainwater's daughter, and we're so happy to have you in the service this morning. We want to mention to you also that this week concludes, or this Sunday, maybe yesterday, some of you, concludes 3 weeks of prayer and fasting that we've engaged here in the church. And I want to thank you and tell you how much I appreciate you participating in these exercises. Sometimes you won't see the result of that for a while, but I can promise you there will be a result. God will respond to that. And I thank those of you who have participated in whatever measure that God laid upon your heart over the last 3 weeks as we join with perhaps thousands of other churches across America to pray and to ask God to heal our land, to forgive our sins, to lift this terrible pandemic from us and so forth, and also to superintend the upcoming elections and to bring peace to the social unrest of our nation as well. I want to mention to you also that next Sunday morning, a portion of that service, not all of it, but a portion of it, I will be speaking and preaching, but a portion of that service in the first part is going to be dedicated to celebrate Brother Jack Goodson's 90th birthday. That's going to happen. Why don't you go ahead and give him a round of applause. He is going to be 90 years young on Monday, that is a week from tomorrow. So next Sunday will be the last Sunday of the month, and it will be the day before his 90th birthday. And we're going to take a little bit of the first part of that service and honor him, and we're going to have some tributes to him and to Frankie, and then we're going to let you give an offering for him. We want to bless his socks off. We really do want to bless him and let him know how much we love him and appreciate him. Our offering is taken, as is the case, has been the case now for a number of months. At the end of the service this morning, Brother Tucker will be there with the holy basket, and you can drop your holy tithes and your holy offerings into the holy basket, and we'll get them to the unholy bank. But it will be, our part will be sanctified, right? Our portion will be sanctified by God's grace. So I want to thank God for your giving. Thank you, Jesus, that you've provided for us all these weeks and months. You've done more than enough. You've done so much more beyond what we could have imagined. And God, they have been some of the best months in the history of our church. And that is a testament to how that we are not limited to circumstances surrounding us, that our God is a God that pours out blessings in the midst of challenges and circumstances that are troubling. So we thank you, Father, for the faithfulness of your people here at North Point to do that. And we ask that you bless them as they exit today, and they give the tithe and the offering in obedience to your word, and we pray that you would pour out a blessing upon them as a result. We ask this in the name above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. We're inviting you to turn with us today to the book of 2 Samuel chapter 6. 2 Samuel chapter 6. We're going to read verses 12 through 15. And this is a little bit of a sermon that I have worked on a little while, and I've held it to this time, I believe, in the will of God, because we are at the conclusion of this 3 week of fasting, and now I'm going to be looking for God to do some things in response to the prayers of his people in this nation. So we begin reading the verse 12, 2 Samuel 6, verse 12. And it was told King David, saying, "The Lord hath blessed the house of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him because of the ark of God." So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they that bare the ark of the Lord had gone six paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. And David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. And I leave off reading there. I'll reference some other verses as we go through. But I want to speak to you, talk to you for a little while this morning on the subject of the nation who brought back God. The nation who brought back God. I hope we can be that. I hope we can be the reality of that. That was reality in that day for the nation of Israel. I hope it can be the reality of this nation in the days that are just before us. King David has recently been anointed and crowned as the new monarch of Israel. Samuel, the prophet, who was prophesying at that period of history, he is the one who anointed David when he was just a little teenage boy, tending sheep out in his father's pastures. He was not even called or recognized by his father when Samuel had come to anoint one of the sons of Jesse. He didn't know which one. And they were all paraded, all but David. David was not even recognized by his dad as being someone that Samuel or God would consider. But Samuel knew all of these that looked like they ought to be kings are not kings. They're not the ones that God has selected. And he said, Jesse, don't you have somebody else? And Jesse said, well, I've got a son that's, he's not much to look at, but he's out in the fields tending sheep. And he said, go get him. So they called him in, and as soon as he walked through the door, Jesse knew this is the one. Because you see, God doesn't look on the outward appearance. God looks on the heart. And Samuel, when he anointed David, he said, this man, he had said it before, but he said, this man, this young boy, he is a man after the heart of God. He is a man who is after God's own heart. And that was the thing that qualified him. That's quite a title, and it's quite a description. I believe it was perhaps the one that David valued more than his political title. I believe he valued that title as being a man after God's own heart more than he ever valued the title as king or monarch over the nation of Israel. King Saul, who preceded David as king, had backslidden on God. And as a result, the nation had also drifted from God. As the scripture says, when the righteous are in leadership, the people rejoice. But when the wicked rule, the people mourn. Proverbs 29 and verse 2. Leadership is important, folks. Leadership in a nation, in a church, in a household. Leadership is important. As the leader goes, so goes the church. As the leader goes, so goes the nation. As the leader goes, so goes the household. So Saul had backslidden on God, and as a result, Israel had been defeated in battle, and the Ark of the Covenant had been stolen by the Philistines. In that particular battle, which was 20 years earlier, the Israelites were losing that battle. And they thought, you know what, we're missing him, we're missing the Ark of God. Well, they had rebelled. They had rebelled against God. As their leader, Saul had rebelled against God. The Ark of God was not a good luck charm. It was not a weapon of warfare per se. It wasn't something that they could just bring in and be guaranteed the victory. It was the God of the Ark, not just the Ark of God, but the God of the Ark that was bringing the victory. And so they said, go get the Ark of God and bring it into the camp because we need help. And you know, a lot of folks are like that. A lot of folks want to bring in God when they get in trouble. And that's not always, it's never a good model, really. I mean, God wants you to call for him when you're in trouble. But he would really like for you to already be calling on him before you get in trouble. And the truth is, if you call on him before you get in trouble, it's very likely that you might not get in trouble. But if you do get in trouble, it won't be hard for you to call upon God. And the Bible says he will deliver you out of all of your troubles unless you're not living right. Unless you're rebelling on God and against God. And that's what the nation was doing. So when they went to get the Ark of God and treated it as some kind of a good luck charm to turn the tide of the battle, you know what happened? The Philistines, they heard the shout of the people. Here comes the Ark of God into the camp. All of the soldiers, those in the battle raised their voices and shouted in victory. But their shout was empty rhetoric because they had rebelled against God. And so when they engaged the battle, the Philistines said, "You better quit yourself like men, because the Ark of the covenant is in the camp of Israel." Even they had heard of the power of that ark, but once again, they were making a mistake. It wasn't the power of the ark of God, but of the God of the ark.
Amen.
That was in view here. And so, guess what happened? They defeated Israel, they captured the ark of God, and they took it and paraded it like a trophy in Ashdod and in some of the other cities of Philistia. 20 years have now passed. David is now king. Saul is dead. And David knows the necessity of the manifest presence of God in their midst. He understands without God, he and the nation will never prosper and will always be at the mercy of their enemies. We need to learn that lesson. It is God who is their great reward. It is God who is the keeper of their head. It is God who is their buckler and shield. It is God and God alone who gives them the victory. The battle is not ours, but the Lord's. And David determines now. He determines to go bring God back to the nation. He understood more than they needed an earthly king, they needed the King of Kings. More than they needed the fear of man, they needed the fear of God. And the glory of Israel had departed and left them. And they needed, David knew, they needed to bring God back to Israel. Folks, this is not unlike the situation and circumstance of our national life today. We are in disarray as a people. We are divided and we are discouraged. We are at war with our enemies and, unfortunately, with one another. We are enduring the continuing effects of a global pandemic. We are struggling with a vacillating economy. Unemployment still threatens America's households in great numbers. Our cities are being treated as war zones. It sounds to me like somebody better go get God. It sounds to me like somebody needs to go bring God back to the nation again. And so I've got three things for you to consider this morning before I complete this message. How do we do this? Do you believe that it is something that we need to do as a nation? I do. Amen. I think it is absolutely imperative. And you say, "Well, Darrell, I didn't know God had left the nation." Well, you better wake up. I'm not saying that he has departed in totality, but I want you to understand that we're not suffering all of this because we've been very good, godly people in this nation. I believe we're suffering much of this, and this is not popular preaching. I understand that. This is not going to exactly build your self-esteem and your confidence, but I do believe that we are suffering most of this because we have dispelled God. We have expelled God from our children's classrooms where they used to learn about God at an early age.
We have expelled God from our judiciary. We have expelled God from our houses of legislation. We have expelled God from our society. We want to take all references to God away. We want, people are telling us that we've got to become tolerable or tolerant of those who rebel against God and want to continue this to the point that God is gone for good. The only reason that we are surviving this is because there are a remnant of churches, there are a remnant of people who still believe that God is our only hope. And we're praying like we have for the last 3 weeks. And I'm not just talking about this church. I'm talking about churches across America and around the world who are crying out to God and saying, God, help us. But folks, the reason that we are enduring what we're enduring, God is saying to us, you want to know what it's like to be without me? Get a taste of it for about 8 months now. Get a feel for it. Because the longer you rebel against my presence, if you keep saying and claiming and prophesying and preaching and legislating and directing, if you keep saying there's no place for God, at least not the God of the Bible, in this nation, God is going to accommodate you. He's going to accommodate the nation. I'm telling you this morning that it is absolutely imperative at this hour, somebody has got to go get God and bring God back to this nation again. In fullness, in power, in sovereignty, in supremacy. Somebody got to go get God. So whose responsibility is it? Who is responsible to bring God back to the nation? David longs to renew the nation to the worship of Yahweh. The worship of Yahweh under Saul's leadership was so diminished that he is reduced to seeking guidance at the end of his life. He is reduced to seeking guidance from the witch of Endor, a spiritualist, a medium, a clairvoyant, if you will. You see, folks, when people reject the worship of the one true God, they will diminish worship to something that is not about God at all. It may be about something they call God. It may be about something that they make up as God. It may be some kind of a broad concept of God that we call people of faith, but it's not about Yahweh. It's not about Jehovah. It's not about Jesus. Now let me tell you something. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 20, the things which the Gentiles, that is unbelievers, sacrifice or worship, they sacrifice to devils. Paul said, I would not that you should have fellowship with devils. Whenever you reject the God of the Bible as your object of worship, when a nation rejects the God of the Bible as their object of worship, whatever you replace him with, and you will replace him with something. One of the things that's going on today in America is nothing more than pantheism. The worship of nature itself. This mad desire to save the planet. And we are willing to go to all extremes to accomplish that. And you know what that is in essence? It is an old false religion called pantheism that says God is in everything and everything is God. All the planet is God. The trees are God. The seas and the ocean are God. And the plants, they're God. And the animals, they're God. And we just happen to be at the top of the food chain. And so they have this thing called the environmental movement. Now listen, I know we need to be good stewards. Don't misunderstand. Need to be good stewards of what God has given us. But I want you to know something. We don't have the power able to save the planet. If we stopped every car from moving at this moment and we went electric 100, we don't have the power to save this planet. There's only one who can save this planet, and his name is Jesus Christ. And one day he's coming. Forever, at least not after the fall. Hallelujah. So whatever we replace the worship of true God, it's going to be a devil behind it. It's going to be a demon. It may look good politically. It may look good socially. You may be able to raise your head and straighten your coat and say, I'm a man of faith. But you are a man of faith in something that goes nowhere. I'm talking about the faith in the God of this Bible. That's what we've got to bring America back to. We are responsible for that. That's what I'm trying to tell you. David longs to restore the worship and presence of Yahweh to the nation. Who is responsible to do that? Listen, folks, this is not some idle whim or some pet project of King David. David wants it to be, listen, I know it doesn't preach well in a country that is multicultural, and I'm fine with that, but a country that now says that Christianity is no more valuable than any other religion, I'm telling you, I reject that. Any other religion in the world is welcome here. We'll shine the light of the gospel. I'm not afraid of the darkness, but I am afraid of putting out the light of the gospel. That's what I'm concerned about. So what I'm saying to you is, David wants it to be a national goal. We are one nation under God. In God we trust. On our national monument, in our national document, we have it printed everywhere. I'm trying to tell you, we are a nation under God, and we've always known until recently what his name was. His name is Jesus. That's the God, Yahweh, Jehovah, Jesus. David wants it to be a national goal. Now, if you look with me, you pray, God help the preacher, quit screaming. He's hurting you. Well, I'm hurting me too. David, look at chapter 6, verse 1. And again, David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah, to bring up from thence the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, that dwelleth between the cherubims. They knew exactly who they were going after. They identified him with complete clarity, specificity. He is the God of the Bible. He is the one who dwells between the cherubims. Let me tell you something, folks. When you're talking about the Ark of the Covenant, that was their Old Testament Emmanuel. That was their Old Testament Emmanuel. The angel said, you call his name, it is Emmanuel. God with us. God with us. That's what the Ark of the Covenant was to the nation of Israel. It was the manifest presence of God that dwelt between the cherubim on top of the mercy seat, on top of the Ark of the Covenant. So what I'm trying to tell you in verse 2 of chapter 6 here, he said, and all the people that were with him. The chronicler in 1 Chronicles chapter 13, verse 2 and 3, speaking of this same episode, said this, quoting David, if it seem good to you, and if it be the will of the Lord, Jehovah, our God, let us send word far and wide to the rest of our brothers throughout the territories of Israel, and also to the priests and Levites who are with them in their towns and pasture lands, to come and join us Come and join us. Let us bring the ark of our God back to us. For we did not inquire of it during the reign of Saul. Whose responsibility is it? Who's going to get it done? Whose responsibility is it to bring back God to the nation? I tell you, it is ours. It is the church of the living God. It is the chosen people. And we can raise our voice in one accord and call the nation back to God. We can call the nation, come with us and let us together bring back God to our nation, the people of God. 2 Chronicles 7:14 puts it like this. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and repent of their sins and pray and believe God, then he said, I will hear the prayer. I will forgive their sin. I will heal their land. So that's where it remains. David established a capital city. He established a city called Jerusalem as the capital city of Israel. He brought the ark back. Folks, listen. He brought the ark back to the capital city. He brought God back, the ark back to the center of the life of the nation. The political life, the social life, the religious life, it all revolved around the capital city and what went on. And there's where David said, we've got to get that ark of God, the presence of God, right back here, right in the middle of the nation. And he placed it there. It was in a tent, but he placed it there. There, God's presence was to be established. Second word I want you to notice is the word accountability. The accountability that goes with bringing God back into the nation. You remember in chapter 4 of this same book, verses 21 and 22, the Philistines, I mentioned it earlier, had captured the ark of God in a battle with Israel. The Philistines took the ark and paraded it like a trophy throughout Ashdod, Gath, and Ekron, cities of Philistia. As a result, the Lord sent disease, cancers, to afflict them so that no one wanted the ark of God at all. They were scared of it. They had good reason to be. They took that ark and treated it with disrespect. The Lord sent these cancers on them, afflicted them. And they took that ark and carried it away. Sent it to a city called Kiriath Jearim. It was about 9 miles west of Jerusalem. Folks, I want to tell you something. When we're talking about, we've got to do it right. We need to get it right in this nation. The reason that on whatever level God has removed himself, and I want to make sure I clarify that in the future, but whatever level God has removed himself is because of the way we have treated his presence. We've got to get that right. They took that Ark of the Covenant up, paraded it like a trophy, and God said, I'm not putting up with that. And he immediately began striking people with cancerous tumors. And they said, we got to get rid of this thing. Folks, if you mistreat or disrespect God's presence, you're going to get judged. You're going to get punished. And so it remained there in Kiriath Jearim for 20 years during the priesthood of Samuel. Now David wants to bring the Ark of the Covenant, but more importantly, the presence of God back to the national life of Israel. Now this is what he did. You can read about it in the first part of this chapter, chapter 6. This is what he did. They got a cart pulled by two camels. or two oxen. And they set the ark in the back of that cart, and they head out for Jerusalem with great fanfare. Then suddenly, something went terribly wrong. Terribly wrong. The cows stumbled, the ark shook, and a man by the name of Uzzah, probably a Levite, riding in that cart, reached out to steady the ark, and God immediately struck him dead. Party over. What happened? I can only, and the Bible says David was displeased. He was put out by that. Now, wait a minute. God, I'm David. I'm the man after your heart. I'm doing something great here. I'm involved in something very important here. I want to go get your presence and bring your presence back into Israel and set it up in the capital city. God, what in the world are you doing? Why are you spoiling the party? Why are you displeased with what something that I'm obviously trying to do for your glory? And I can almost, can't quote this from Scripture. David stopped the procession. He sent that cart and that ark and those, he sent him over to the house of Obed-Edom. And he left it there. And David now is in such discouragement. And I can almost hear God saying to David, David, did you know that not a single one of you, not one of you, consulted Scripture about how to treat my presence? Not one of you. David, I know you're a man after my heart. You didn't read Scripture. You didn't take time to find out how I wanted my presence to be treated, how I wanted my presence to be revered, how I wanted my presence to be respected. David, you don't get to make up the rules about this. What you have chosen to do was what you saw the ungodly Philistines do when they took the ark. They put it in a cart and carried it away. That's not what I said. That's not what I told my people in the book of Leviticus. The only way this ark could be touched and could be moved, it couldn't be touched. The only way it could be moved would be by Levites taking staves and putting them through the corner rings of the ark, and that's how you carry the ark. Any other way is unacceptable. And any other way, you're going to get judged for it. You say, well, preacher, now what in the world is so bad about that? That's the problem. We think that we can handle God's presence any way we want to. We want to make the rules. We want to put it together ourselves. And what we end up doing is falling into using worldly techniques and worldly methodologies, just like David did. This is how they did it. We can bring him back the same way they took him. No, you can't. No, you can't. And so, there is a prescribed manner in Scripture that informs us, teaches us, instructs us about how we are accountable when we are handling the presence of God. Now get with me, okay? I know this is something that you think, well, it's not really even important to know. Yes, it is. Part of the reason that we're in the shape we're in this very hour is this reason right here. Amen. The way we handle the presence of God, the way that the church has handled the presence of God to some extent. Here's what I'm saying. God is serious about how we treat His presence. So if we're going to go get God, if we're going to bring God back to the nation, We better get rid of all of these ideologies that say we've got to be relevant to the people. We've got to be relevant to the culture. We've got to use techniques and methodologies that will attract them. You better give that stuff up.
Amen.
God wants you to do it His way, a holy way, a sacred way, a right way, a powerful way. And we do it God's way, God will give His blessing on that. No one, including David, had taken time to read the scripture. And they used those methods. Folks, we're responsible. We're accountable to bring God's presence back to the nation. We're accountable for how we do it. When we ignore His truth, what the scripture says about how we treat God's presence, we're accountable. When we relegate Him to some guest room or some nominal place of unimportance and we kind of push Him back, in the shadows of the national landscape, God, you get back there. You get back there in that private place. We'll let you know when we need you. We're accountable. When we bring Him out only when we're in a crisis, we're accountable. When we don't treat Him with reverence at all, when we ignore His presence, except in times of crisis, we're accountable. Folks, God wants us to treat His presence with the reverence, the awe, the dignity, the power that He is as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God will have nothing to do with it if it is a worldly methodology. Now, I want you to know that's part of what's wrong, and I'm getting ready close. I know I'm dragging, but I'm getting ready to get to the last point quick. That's part of what's wrong with us now as a nation. If you want me, God is saying, if you want me, you can come and get me. If you seek me, you will find me. But you need to pay attention to how you treat me when I get there. You need to be careful about how you treat me when I come. Galatians chapter 6 and verse 7 said, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked." God is not mocked. "For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap." Last point. I'd love to stop right there and preach a bit more, but I've lost about half of you already.
Preach on, brother.
But let me tell you, this is something maybe stir you up a little bit. I'll talk to you for a moment as I close about the profitability of bringing God back to the nation. The profitability. We're looking there at verses 12 through 15, our text. This is really where the text comes from. You say, well, preacher, is it worth it? Is it worth it? Now, folks, let me tell you something. Some of us, even sitting here in this building, you hear a message like this and you think, you know, but Darrell, it's just not all that. We just need to get through this and get over this and get back to, we'll be all right. We can get the economy rebuilt and we can get vaccines and we can get everything started up again. Everything's going to be okay. You are missing it. That's the whole problem. You are missing the point. That's what got us into this mess. And if we don't, as we're coming out, and we are, that's what I'm concerned about. We are beginning to come out of it right now. I feel it. I know we are. We are coming out of this crisis. But if we haven't changed and recognized and realized what got us into it, we're going to make the same mistakes again, even greater. And when we do it next time, I don't know if there's going to be a recovery. I don't know if there can be a recovery next time. I don't want there to be a next time. I want us to get it right this time. Are you understanding what I'm saying? I want us to get it right this time. When we bring God back to the nation, I want it to be right and I want it to stay right for us. This is what happens when we do it. You say, well, preacher, is it worth it? Oh, yes, it is. You see, it took David two times, but he got it right the second time. Maybe you've messed up before like David, but you can try again. Maybe God has his manifest presence you've not experienced that in a long time. Maybe God has left your house. I want to tell you something. You can get him back. I'm talking about his manifest presence. You can get him back. He'll come back to you. He'll come back to your home. He'll come back to your situation. He'll help you. He'll bless you. Is it worth it? Yes, it is. There is a great prophet. David went to get God again, but this time he did it God's way, not his way or the world's way. Look at the difference that it made. Number one, in verse 12, here's what happened. He saw that God blessed the house of Obed-Edom. Obed-Edom was where the ark was taken when David messed up the first time. But you know what? 3 months it was there, and the 3 months it was there, because Obed-Edom was respectful. He valued the presence of that ark, and he treated it with honor and respect, and God blessed his socks off. The Bible says that they came to David and said, ever since that ark has been in the house of Obed-Edom, God has blessed him and everything in his house and everything that pertains to him. God has blessed him. And David said, well, that's what I want. I want that in the nation. So I want to go get it out of the house of Obed-Edom, and I want to bring it back here to the capital city. Let me tell you, there's a good pattern there for us to notice. The pathway of bringing God back to the nation is going to run through your house. God's not just going to magically show up in Washington. If God comes back to the capital city, if we have revival, dare I say it? Dare I believe it? Dare I proclaim it? If we have revival in the capital city, it's only going to happen because it first broke out in the house of Obed-Edom. Because it first broke out in your house and in my house. God blessed him. And verse 12 said it was because of the ark of God. God blessed his house and all that pertained to Obed-Edom. And folks, listen to me. God wants to bless you and all that pertains to you. His presence will accomplish that. You know why some of us, many of us, I know. You know why some of us, many of us, have fared quite well? You know why? I'm not being arrogant, please. God, you know about my heart. I say it humbly. I say it in contrition. I say it in glory to your name. You know why North Point Church has flourished during these months more than in the history of our church? Because of the way we treat God. Amen. That's why. Amen. Because the blessing of God has been upon this church house and upon this people. You know why you have flourished and other people are looking at you and saying, how in the world are you making it? We can't even pay next month's light bill. How are you making it? It's because I've got the presence of God in my house, in my life, and God is blessing my soul. So I'm not having to rely on circumstances surrounding me. But God is my source. God is my helper. God is my strength. God is my ability. It's God. It's God. It's God. It's God. And folks, that's what we've got to get back into the nation. Hallelujah. I gotta quit it.
Bless him, Lord.
I gotta quit it.
Bless him, Lord. Bless him, Lord.
Or God will quit me here in a moment if I'm not careful. When I think about the way our nation has been blessed for two centuries, we came from nothing. Settlers, pilgrims, the way God has blessed us. And in 2.5 centuries, almost, little less. We've become the greatest nation on the face. We became that after World War II.
Amen.
Greatest nation on the face of the earth. You think that happened because of our... Listen, we've made so many mistakes. We have done so many things wrong as a nation.
Yes.
We have sins in our past and in our present that have been horrific, horrific sins. But here's the difference. We're a redemptive nation. And we're still repenting. And we've repented of so many things that are wrong. And as long as our trust was in God, as long as we were trying with God's help to form a more perfect union, the hand of God was on us. But over the last 40 years, 50 years, we have taken a direction that has been opposite of what we have done in those past two centuries. And I'm not going to go and preach that again. But I do want to tell you, as I look at verse 13, the first one was the blessing that God saw, or that David saw in the house of Obed-Edom, the blessing of God's presence in the house, in the nation. But the next one here is verse 13 about how to handle the presence of God. Repentance precedes his blessing and presence. In verse 13, what David had done before was wrong, it failed. But now David's going to do it right. Now, watch me. David now has the ark being borne by the Levites. They're not touching it. They have the golden staves covered over acacia wood. And they're in the corner rings of the ark. And they're carrying the ark. And they're getting ready to leave the house of Obed-Edom. And David is leading the procession, and there are others that are with him, and David does this. They take off, and David says, come on, we're going back to the capital city. We're taking the blessings of the house of Obed-Edom with us. We're going to have these blessings fall upon us as a nation. And so this is what he does. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Hold up! Bring some oxen, or bring some fatlings, some lambs. We got some repenting to do.
Yeah.
6 steps. 6 is the number of a man. And I cannot help but believe that David is saying, this is far as we're going in the power of our flesh.
Right.
This is as far as we're going in our humanity right now before we take another step. We're going to recognize this thing is not dependent on our humanity. It is dependent upon his divinity in us.
Yeah.
And so what David does is he slaughters those animals. They sacrifice. They repent before God. And in the Bible, they're down on their knees. They repent before God. They are repenting before God. They know that repentance precedes the blessing of God. And they're repenting. And then David gets up and says, now, okay, let's dance before the Lord in the power of his might. Let's give glory to God. Sound the trumpet. May we lead the way with repentance.
Yeah. Mm. Thank you, Holy
the fourth God. Thing in verse 12 was gladness. That is in verse 12 of chapter 6. They were doing that with gladness. The joy of the Lord is our strength.
Amen.
I like that old chorus we used to sing.
Amen.
He has made me glad.
Yeah.
He has made me glad.
Yeah.
I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Amen. Final thing here that I mentioned in verse 14, they worshiped, and I've already told you that.
Yes.
He danced with all of his might. Now look at what he did. He took off his royal robes. I don't know when he did it or where he did it, but they were off because the Bible says he put on, in verse 14, he put on a linen ephod, which is the garment of a priest. David knew that me being king is not going to impress God.
That's right.
Take off those royal robes, David. When you come before God, you're just like anybody else. You're held to the same standard. It's the same accountability. And David took off those robes and put on that linen ephod and said, together as worshipers, hallelujah, of the Most High God, together as followers of the Most High God, together as those who repent before the Most High God, we're bringing God back to the nation. Now, folks, listen, God can save our nation again.
Yes, he can.
God can bless our nation again.
Yes, he can.
God can bless your home again.
Amen.
We've got to bring God back.
Amen.
And we've got to do it right this time.
Amen.
May we pray.
Thank you, Father.
Blessed Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your name.
Yes.
Glory to your name. Hekatamashaya. Eya satama shotamakia. Rehamatai. Ekon shatamasia. Fetonamakai. Lesatamashitanamokaya. Holotamasia. Gakatamashi. Akatamashi. Akatamashi. Glory to your name, Jesus. Glory to your name, Jesus. Oh God, let, I pray, God, your people be filled with gladness as we embark upon this new season in our life and in the life of our nation. Oh God in heaven, let people of our church this morning, people, God, who have grown perhaps cold and indifferent, and they've not been embracing the presence of God like they should, even in the house. God, let them this morning, as it were, bring the presence of God back into their home and back into their lives with rejoicing. Lord, let it spread over to the church house, and let it, Lord, spread from the church house to the capital city and all across America. God, we want to be a people who are called by your name once again. We want to be strong in your power and in your might. And God, we're going to do it. We're going to do it. We're going to be part of the chosen ones who join the holy throng of bringing the presence of God back to this nation. And we pray, God, that you would do it for us. Do it in us. Do it through us. In the name of the Father. In the name of the Son. Hallelujah. In the name of the Holy Spirit. Oh God, it is you. 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 Lord Jesus, let the overwhelming, overpowering, omniscient, omnipresent presence of the Lord Jesus fill this house today in our lives. If there are people here this morning who need to be saved, save them, Lord. If there are people, God, who are drifting, bring them back this morning, God. Kindle a fire in them and in us. Help us, God, to be part of this revival. Help us to lead in this revival. God, heal sick bodies. Let the power of the Holy Ghost so move in our midst that people are being healed in masses. Let there not just be one miracle person as there is here this morning. Lord God, let there be masses of people who are walking, talking, demonstrating miracles because of the presence of God back in the church and in the nation. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Hallelujah to your name. Holy, holy is your name. We bless your name. Your name is above every name. You are high and holy and lifted up in our midst. You are the only wise God, and there is none other. We call out.
Thank you.
power of his name today in Jesus' name.
Hey, cut that out.